Hello and welcome back to Practical Digital Preservation Training. It's so good to see so many names returning. And if this is just your first time, no worries. This first session was recorded and we invite you to check it out on the Community Hub. My name is Laurie Ashley. I'm with Turnsol Consulting. That's my own company, but I was with Preservica for 4 years and I'm still considered a friend of the family. And so I was asked to help facilitate this. Because I was involved in Starter from the very beginning. And so I'm delighted to be here with you today. We've got a really packed program for you and it's gonna be a lot of fun. So we're gonna have a really great training session by Paul Clark, Preservica's training coordinator. And he's gonna do a deeper dive than last time into Starter so that you are comfortable with how the solution works and you're ready to get started if you haven't already tried it out. And then we're gonna be joined by Jillian Stanek, who's the archives coordinator from the city of Red Deer, and she's going to fill our segment of preservation in practice. And she's got some great information about what they're doing at the city archives, how she's handled challenges and opportunities, and how she's going gangbusters. We are going to have time for Q&A, and Jillian and our onboarding special Aubrey will be joining us along with Paul. And then we'll just do a brief wrap up of what's coming up next steps, so that you know when to join us for the next training session. But before we get started, wanted to do a shout out to our friends, the Association of Canadian Archivists and ARMA Canada, who have helped supported getting the word out about this training. And we're delighted that you did so and so happy to be among you and part of the community. So before we kick it off with Paul, this is Aubrey. She's our onboarding specialist and she's going to remind you about the Community Hub, but also has an icebreaker discussion question for you. Take it away, Aubrey.
Hi, everyone. Nice to see some of you again and to see some new names in the chat. As Laurie said, I'm the onboarding specialist for Starter and Starter Plus. Before we get going with the demo today, I just wanted to remind you all of the amazing resources you have access to as Starter users, which is our Community Hub. It is a great place to get conversations going and to ask questions about Starter and digital preservation. If we go over to the Canada Training Series group on the Hub, I've shared just a quick little icebreaker post as well as some answers to questions from last week's session. So just a reminder of how to get there. And we'll start with the icebreaker post. So as many of you may be, I'm also a huge lover of history. So I would love to hear about your weird and wonderful archives finds. I shared my story in there and I can share it with you now. But my personal favorite find was working at the Small House Museum. And we uncovered this small wooden box that had been sitting in an attic, seemingly untouched for decades. And in that box was a little collection of hats. They were kind of small, undated, just a little bit of a weird find. And we spent a great deal of time, well, mostly me, it was my research project. I spent a great deal of time researching the couple of hats that actually did have labels, and not a lot of them did. And we kind of discovered that they were probably from the late 1800s to early 1900s. And it seemed like it was almost like a collection of costume hats for children or something like that. It was a really cool find. Again, my first real archives research project and the first items that I actually accessioned into a collection. And so it's always special to me. And I really would love to hear if y'all have any other similar stories or if you have some interesting things in your archive. What do y'all have going on in your collection? We'd love to hear about it. And then really briefly, I can go back and go over the questions from last session. So we only had three questions that didn't get answered. So the first question was, is it possible to convert files from formats that have specific licensing or Mac files to more long-term accessible formats like PDF, either upon ingest or later on? The answer for that is for files that require specific licenses, it's very unlikely that we will ever support migration for those due to licensing implications and because we very rarely, if ever, come across a use case to do it. We don't do Apple specific files as again, there's little demand for that migration pathway at the moment. The second question is what about PDFA format? Is that available in Preservica? And yes, we can ingest and render them. But in Starter, we don't migrate to it. So the usual migration pathway we use for PDF files in CE and above goes to PDFA. However, it is not a reliable migration. It often messes up the orientation, pictures, fonts. So we turned it off for Starter. And the final question is, are there any limitations or restrictions on ingesting particular file formats? And essentially, no, you can ingest any file format you want, whenever you want, but you won't necessarily be able to render it. And so I'm looking forward to hearing some of the great questions you have today, either in our Q&A, or if you think of something afterwards, feel free to post it in that community hub and we will get back to you, either myself or one of our other fantastic team members will answer your questions. So with that, I will hand it over to Paul.
Thanks, Aubrey. Let me just interrupt. So here's Paul's going to kick off the training. And then, as I mentioned, we'll be joined by Jillian Stanek. In a little bit. So sit back, enjoy the presentation. This just shows you where we are in the series. We're in session number two, Essential Skills. We've got two more coming up in August, Building the Business Case and Looking Towards the Future. So we hope you can join us for those two. So now with that, deep dive, training with Paul.
Okay, so let's just make sure I'm sharing my screen and hopefully you are seeing that. So hello again, my name is Paul Clark. I'm the training manager here at Preservica and welcome from a hot and sunny Oxfordshire in the UK. So in the previous session, we looked briefly at Starter, navigating around the system and ingesting and preserving a single file. So in this session, we'll go more in depth and start off by looking at how we can upload a folder which contains files of different formats and how that's uploaded and preserved. We'll also look at how we can upload a zip file, which also contains multiple assets and how Starter preserves those contents. And we'll then examine the advanced information about those preserved assets to see a bit more information. We'll then move on to flexible collection management, where we can look at how we can add metadata manually to our assets. Also how we can delete content or using the recycle bin. And then using the public private switch to allow us to share our content publicly through the public portal. And then finally, operating at scale, we'll look at the functionality where we can upload a folder with files and metadata in bulk, and also the editing metadata in bulk function available in Starter Plus. So that's what we're going to be going through. Kind of suggest that you sort of watch as I go along through this and then have a look around and try out yourselves a bit later on. So I'm going to switch over to my Starter system. So we can see the asset here that I ingested last week, that's still safely preserved in my system. But what I'm going to do this time is I'm actually going to create a new folder that I'm going to be ingesting and uploading all this content into today. So you don't necessarily have to do this, but if you want to sort of organize your content or folder structure first in Starter, you can do that, or you can just simply drag and drop the content and the structure as it is directly into Starter. But to add a new folder, we can come up to the add area here and I have an option that says create a new folder. So I'm going to click on that and I'm going to give the folder a name, which is mandatory. Description is optional. So I'm just going to paste that into there so you haven't got to watch me struggle typing. And I'm just going to add that into the description as well and click on create folder. Okay, so that confirms that folder has been created and we see that appearing here. And the default setting for the folder itself is set to private. So at this stage, only myself can see any content in there. Okay, and obviously at the moment, if I click into there, there is nothing in there because I haven't actually uploaded any content yet. So the first set of content I'm going to upload is going to contain some example file formats. So let me bring that across so you can see that. So let me just make sure I've got that open. and it's visible to you. Let's move that across. Hopefully you can see that. So here we have a folder containing various file formats. So in here, I have three files, a movie file, a TIFF image, and a JPEG 2000 image file. So I'm going to drag and drop that folder containing those three example files into my starter system. So it's a relatively small amount. You can drag and drop anything up to around 4 gigabytes as a whole into this area. Okay, so as I move that across from my other screen into here, we see that drag and drop function appearing as I drag that into there. So I can then just drop that in. And as soon as I drop that in, it's then uploading that content into Starter. So we can see the size of that content. 15 megabytes uploaded pretty quickly. It then moves on to the preserving workflow. So we can then see that in action in terms of completing the automated steps to complete that preservation. So as it's going through there, we can see it's checking for duplicates, identifying the file format, so it can then understand what to do with the migration rules around that. And we'll see that as it completes in a second. So that's completed. Pretty quickly for that set of content. We can close that and hide the notification. So there's still a few things going on in the background. So as I drill down into that folder, we'll see the three assets. It's generating some thumbnails, which will be the images that appear instead of these icons. At the moment, it's just showing sort of the default icon for that specific file format. And it's also completing the migration of that content into alternative formats for preservation and accessibility purposes. So that'll take a few seconds to complete. So whilst that's happening, let's look at how we can also upload a zip file. So slightly different behavior for a zip file. So again, if I just bring that across in my folder here, upload a zip folder, I have a folder.zip file which contains a couple of another folder which contains a couple of Word documents. Okay, so what I'm going to be doing here is uploading the zip file, but the workflow will unpackage that zip file and preserve the contents within it. So it's not preserving the zip file as a file, it's unpackaging, preserving those two Word documents. Okay, so for that, what we have to do is actually run the option from the add menu, which says upload a single file or zip. Okay, so when I click on that, it will then ask me to navigate to where that content exists. There it is. I select the zip file, open that up, and once again, it goes through the same workflow in terms of uploading. Again, small amount of content in the interest of time, won't take very long. And then it goes through those same steps again for checking file creation, file format identification, and then finally creating the structure. So that will then add a new folder into my top level practical digital preservation training folder here. Okay, so we can see that that's now created a folder here. And my first folder that was created just now, containing those various file formats, now has a thumbnail, which I can change if I want by right clicking and choosing change thumbnail, along with other actions that are available here, which we'll look at as we go through. But if I now drill down into that first folder, we can still see the three assets that were uploaded, but we now see the thumbnails generated for that as well. Okay, so what's also happened now is if I drill down into these assets is I'll see a bit more information. So again, I can right click on an asset and perform certain actions against that, or I can double click on the asset to then do things like downloading that asset seeing the history of the asset, so anything that's happened to that asset since the point of ingestion. Okay, and that's either automated tasks or user tasks. So in here, I've got a metadata tab. At the moment, the only metadata in here is the name of the file. I'll look and show you in a second how we can add more. And then if I go to preservation history, this is where we can really drill down and see the details about our original preservation representation asset and any additional representations that have been automatically generated by the migration business rules built into Starter. So here I've got my original, which is my .mov file, my movie file. I can download that original file if I need to. I can look at the advanced information about that file. So if I click on here, it gives me all the technical information about that particular format. So a .mov file, better known as a QuickTime format, it gives me all the details and properties of that particular file type. Okay, so that's our original, what's called preservation representation. Okay, but then what's also happened is Starter has created an access representation. Okay, so this is preserving our original file in an alternative format, but also creating a format that's more accessible or better found through a browser, played through a browser in this case, an MP4 file. Okay, so a .mov file may not necessarily be a format that can play through all browsers, whereas an MP4 is a much more recognized format for that. So we can see the MP4 generated here. We can download that MP4 if we need to. And again, we can see the advanced information for that. Okay, so if I click on advanced information, I now see all the details about the MP4. Okay, so we can see there in the space of a few seconds that we've uploaded and preserved our files within our Starter system. Okay, and if I switch back to our second folder there that I ingested that contained those two Word documents, we can see that zip file has been unpackaged. The two Word documents have been preserved. I can click into there. Again, I can go to the preservation history. And in this instance, it's treated Word documents differently. So there's our original Word document that's been preserved. It's then created what's called another preservation representation in ODT, which is open document text format, and then also created our access representation in PDF. Okay, so it's preserved and made that file accessible by generating two more representations of that. Okay, so that's where you can sort of really drill down, see that content and see the preservation and access representations that's been created. Okay, so that's how we can easily upload and preserve assets within a folder and how we can view details about that content as well. Okay, and as mentioned, other actions can be done in terms of right-clicking on an asset, renaming it, changing the thumbnail, deleting it, which we'll look at more later. Okay, and also within the asset itself, downloading and seeing the history. Okay, so that covers the first part of the training in terms of getting started with Starter and how to get content into Starter and view advanced information. So I'll hand back to Laurie at this stage.
Thanks, Paul. We wanted to stop at the end of these sessions, these sections, and just have a question. So the thing that comes to my mind, and Aubrey, please join in, is, you know, what's so powerful about Starter is this automated transformation. And so Paul's showed us a couple of examples and how you can see in preservation history. At the last session, we talked to, or introduced a little bit the registry of file formats, which Preservica leverages in order to do what it does inside the system. But Aubrey, I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about the automated transformation. So how do people using Starter understand what is that automated transformation? You mentioned in the Q&A from last time that we don't transform to PDFA in Starter. So I think just talk a little bit about that transformation process and how people can best understand what's going on there.
Yeah, I in terms of the like super technical specifics, I'm not 100% an expert on it, but I do know that you know, from what Paul showed, it makes it very seamless, and it is sorry, having an issue with my throat here, but it makes it very seamless, and it's almost, you know, like you're just uploading something into Google Drive. It's so quick and easy, as you saw from his uploads, but it's really a sophisticated process that's actually taking those files and transforming them into something that we can preserve on those multiple sites through AWS. So it is actually active digital preservation, and to have it be so quick and easy, I think is really it's really amazing and really, really useful, insanely useful tool.
Well, and I think I just know from all the archivists that I've spoken to over time, you know, there are decisions that have to be made about what are the preservation formats, what are the access formats. And so I think that, you know, Preservica is leveraging the good practice out there that it understands, and making it easy for folks to do. And different decisions could be made, of course. Maybe when Jillian speaks later, she'll talk to us about whatever strategy that they've got for preferred or supported file formats. But I think it's pretty slick that it does that transformation on upload, and that looking in the advanced information, you can always find out what happened. I do think it's a good teaching
Absolutely.
Tool for archivists who are educating people about what's different with a digital preservation system. So I think it's great that it's so easy to see, and that it's just sort of happening automatically. So it's very, very powerful stuff.
Yeah, just very quick and easy. And like I said, yeah, it's literally like uploading something into a Google Drive, and you don't have to even think about it, but there is a really sophisticated process happening. And that was one of the things that really drew me to Starter before I even was with Preservica, was this is something that you can use in your archive to really streamline the process and to make it easier to make those file format decisions.
Yep, it's great stuff. Okay, back to you, Paul, for the next section.
Sure, so flexible collection management. So we'll look at manually adding metadata, deleting content and using recycle bin, and making our content publicly accessible. So while I switch back again to my Starter system, so manually adding metadata. So if I go back into my first folder that I ingested here, and let's go back to our movie file. So from in here, one thing I didn't show before is simply the fact that you can play that movie file directly by running it through that thumbnail and playing it from there. So we can see that this is a film about the scene from the elevator ascending Eiffel Tower. So that would be a good description to add into our metadata field here. So what I can do is I can click on this little pen icon here, and that will open up the description field here to add in that piece of text in there. And I can click on the tick to save that. So some pretty basic descriptive metadata added there. But it might be that actually I want more metadata than that, because having metadata associated with your content is really important in terms of providing more information about that asset, but also allowing other users, specifically the public, to find that content. So if I wanted to, I've just been logged out, apologies for that. If I wanted to allow users externally to see that content, then for them to be able to find it, they need to search, and having metadata allows users to then search that content. Okay, let me just log in again. There we go, apologies for that. So back to where we were. So having more descriptive metadata about our content can obviously be good from an information point of view, but also really helpful from users to find content. So what we have here is the ability to choose a metadata template. And at the moment, we offer Dublin Core and mods, two of the more popular archivist metadata templates available. So if I select Dublin Core, that then opens up the add metadata button, which I can select. And then it allows me to add descriptive metadata based on the standard Dublin Core fields. So I think there's about 15 or so available in there. Okay, so what I can then do is add in metadata appropriate to each of those fields where necessary. So actually in description, I'm gonna just put that same description in that I put in before. Okay, and again, I could put in more things like dates and type and format and things like that's appropriate. So I could put in here, you know, .mov as the format as well. So once I've put all of that in, I can then save that metadata. And then what we see is only the metadata that we've entered. So we don't see any null or empty fields because there's no point in seeing that. So I can delete it, I can edit that metadata further if I want. Okay, and that content will then appear on my public facing portal if I then make that asset public, which we'll look at in a second. And we'll also look at how we can upload metadata in bulk and also edit metadata in bulk in part three. So that's how we can work with metadata manually. Moving on to the recycle bin. So we know that the priority is all about preserving our digital content. Okay, but there may be occasions when we actually need to delete content. So either because we don't need it, possibly duplicate content, or we're actually required legally or for regulation purposes to actually delete it or remove it or replace it with something more up to date. So what we can do is delete content, but what we're actually doing is not permanently deleting our content. We're putting it into a recycle bin, which we can still access and if necessary, restore from. Okay. Once content has been in the recycle bin for 90 days, then it will be automatically permanently deleted. Okay. But within that 90-day period, we can restore it if necessary. You can also empty the recycle bin, i.e. delete everything in there ahead of the 90-day period if you want. So how does this work? Well, we can either delete folders or we can delete assets. So if I go back to my home area and look at my top level folders, if I wanted to delete that whole folder, I can right click on the folder and choose delete folder. Okay. Or if I wanted to delete an individual asset, again, let's pick on our movie file, I can right click and I can delete asset. Okay. So if I click on that, notice it doesn't give you any sort of warning in terms of, are you sure you want to do this? It will go ahead and delete it. And as you can see here, it's telling me that that's on its way into the recycle bin. So that will then refresh, confirm that that's completed. And then down here, we have the recycle bin. Okay, and it's telling me there are actually three entities within my recycle bin. Okay, so some stuff I've deleted previously, so a folder, and a couple of assets. Okay, here's my option up here to empty that recycle bin completely. So if I wanted to delete everything now from my recycle bin, I could click that. If I wanted to examine my recently deleted movie file, if I click on it, it won't let me see it. So I do actually need to restore it back into my starter system to actually view that movie file. Okay, so if I wanted to restore it, maybe I've accidentally deleted it, it's within that 90-day period, so I can restore it from here. Okay, so that's now going to move it back from my recycle bin back into my exact location that it was in before. So if I go back into my practical digital preservation folder, into my folder here, there is my 1847 movie file, safely restored, and hopefully nobody would be any the wiser that's been deleted and restored. Other than the fact, obviously, under the history of asset, that audit trail shows, let's just show that again, that yes, it was deleted and restored, but hopefully nobody will look in there. So that's how we can use the recycle bin and delete content in Starter if we need to. So next, it's making our content publicly accessible. So another sort of key function and benefit of having your content in Starter is that ability to choose which content you wish to keep private and that which you want to share and make public. So again, this can be done at both folder and individual asset level. Okay, so the default for content that you ingest into a folder is set to private. So if you then want to make it public, you then need to do that yourself. So if I wanted to make a whole folder public, I can right click on the folder and simply choose the public option here. Okay, if I just wanted an individual asset within a folder to be public, again, I can select the asset and choose the public option here. Okay, but let's say actually I do want to make that whole folder that I've created public. So I'm going to right click on there and choose the public setting here. So that's now making that folder and subfolders and assets public. And we'll see that we then get an eye icon appearing in the top left hand corner to indicate that folder is now public. And if I drill down into that, the two subfolders have that same icon. For assets, we have a slightly different icon here to indicate that those assets are now public. So now I've done that, how does it look on my public portal? Well, what I can do is select the asset, and we now have an option called View Public. Okay, so that only shows if the asset is set to public. So if I now click on that, that now takes me into my public portal. I now see that asset, I can now play that asset. This will be the MP4 representation. So having that access representation now means that I can play that video in my public portals. It's in a format that's now accessible. Okay, so I can click on play and that will play nicely as we go through. Any metadata that's been added also appears. Okay, so I've got my title, I've got my simple piece of metadata that I added here, but I've also got my Dublin core metadata with that description format that appears there. Okay, so any metadata will also be visible. And again, only the metadata that's been added will show. Okay, then got options to share this content. So via email, Facebook, Twitter. Again, the user can download that and that'll be the access representation, MP4. They can mark it as a liked asset. So if they want to show that, they can. And then they can also navigate through the whole collection. So we can see a path up here of that actual folder structure. So I can switch back to the folder that asset is in. I can see those other assets that are in there. I can look at those as well if I want. Okay. The only thing you need to be a little bit careful about is having a mixture of public and private settings within your structure. Because if you have perhaps a top level folder that's public and then a subfolder that's private and then assets within that subfolder that are public, because that structure is mixed, that path here would not necessarily show as a complete path because you've got a mixture of public and private in there. Okay. Okay, so that covers flexible collection management. Back to you again, Laurie.
So quick question for Aubrey, Dublin Core or Mods? Do you have a favorite? Do you have some experience using either or both?
Yeah, so I've used both. I prefer Dublin Core personally, just because I feel like it is, honestly, because it is more popular, I feel like more people are more comfortable with it currently, but that's, you know, always subject to change. Metadata is always evolving. And every archivist has their own preference, but for now, I think Dublin Core is really the standard, and it makes it really easy to use on Starter, which I appreciate. And I think most of the people that I've talked to that use Starter are using Dublin Core, so I think it's a lot of people's preference right now. But I would love to hear from those of you in attendance about your preference on metadata. What do you like? Why do you like, you know, mods better than Dublin Core? Do you have a different metadata standard that you prefer and why? I'd love to hear that from all of you.
And I think, you know, metadata is so important in the archives. And I think what my experience has been that archivists often get very poor metadata when things are accessioned into the archives. So I think that having, you know, a schema, whether or not it's the one you ultimately use, is so helpful for consistency and standardization and evolving, right, the organization's approach to metadata. And so I think, you know, it's good to have the two very standard choices already built into the system. I wanted to talk a little bit about the recycle bin. I think that I know that lots of folks sort of hesitate about putting content in because, you know, it's an archive and archivists are careful and conscientious and considered people. But I do think that having the recycle bin hopefully will make people comfortable with just try this, right? Put something in, play with the metadata. You can always pitch it if you want to. But I do want to point out too, I want you to explain to us, Aubrey, the difference between Starter and Starter Plus, because Starter, as Paul has said, is a single user solution. But in Starter Plus, some of those features that Paul showed, like an audit trail, would allow you to see what other users are doing in the system. So can you just clarify the how that works differently in Starter and Starter Plus in terms of users?
Yeah, absolutely. So as you already said, Starter is just the one user. Obviously, if you have multiple people that have access to that email, you can still use that, but it's just the one user. Whereas in Starter Plus, you do have the added flexibility to have a couple other added users, and you can track the changes across those users, which is really great. So say you had an intern using it, an intern account, you can kind of take stock of what they're doing on their account, but they would have their own separate workspace. Essentially, you can all access it at the same time, that kind of thing. So yeah, those are the main differences user-wise.
And what I've seen is, you know, somebody has to advance the business case, right, and get approval right to use it. And what I've seen is that if someone's comfortable with it, then they want their staff. It's a training tool. It's a way of, as you said, professional development, of getting people on the same page, making sure that things are done in a consistent way. And if your staff hasn't had a chance to have their hands on a digital preservation tool, then it can be really useful for people to just try it out and then to have those important discussions about what is the workflow, what is the metadata standard, who's going to do which part of the process. So I've seen somebody start out with one and then expand.
Yeah, and it is a great tool as well. So if you're a larger repository and you're thinking, okay, this still, even with Starter Plus, is maybe not going to be what I need, it is still a great starting point for you to say, okay, we'll do Starter Plus for a year and then potentially think about CE. And you can kind of get a preview of those features. Because down the line in CE, those later editions, you get even more functionality in terms of users. So it is a great tool to kind of show your stakeholders the beginnings of what is possible with Preservica.
That's great. Thank you. So back to you, Paul.
Okay, so let's move on to operating at scale. So a great piece of functionality that will get you quickly up and running with getting content and metadata in is the bulk metadata upload. So there is an element of preparation outside of Starter before sort of completing this. So in terms of Starter itself, we will go through how we can ingest this content in bulk via the add and upload a folder with metadata using one of the templates option. But before I go into that, let's just have a look at the content and the preparation side of things. So what I have, again, if I just bring that across, is a folder that's prepared that contains three assets. So a PDF, a JPEG, and a JPEG 2000. Okay, so three assets. But I've also got some prepared Dublin Core metadata. Okay, could be mods as well, but in this example, I'm using Dublin Core again. So that metadata that you have prepared may be in, you know, text format, XML format, or a spreadsheet, or anywhere. Okay, but what I've got is that prepared metadata. So this is metadata that corresponds to those three assets. So I'm just opening that up in Excel and let's bring that across so you can see it. Okay, so I've got my Dublin Core metadata fields, not complete metadata, not every field is complete, but I've got the details that I want to associate with the metadata for that. So that's all prepared. And as I say, you may have that in a spreadsheet, it could be in a text file, whatever, as long as it's prepared. Okay, so I've got that in place as well. So everything's ready and good to go. So I'm then going to, let's just move these out of the way. I'm going to start the process. So over here, again, I'm just making sure I'm in the folder that I want to ingest into. I'm going to go to upload a folder with metadata using one of the templates. So the first thing that we need to do is download the template for the metadata schema that we want to then associate our metadata with. Okay, so there is more information about this as well on the Community Hub, which you can access via that link, via that question mark icon. So I'm going to download my Dublin Core template. So this is the template that Starter requires to then be able to validate and upload the metadata associated with the content. So I'm just going to open that up. So all I've done here is just download that template. Okay, and I'm going to just copy that or move it from here into my prepared area. So let's bring that across. Apologies for the screen moving. So I'm just going to bring that into here. Okay, and I'm just going to rename it as well. So we'll call this bulk DC metadata. Okay, and that's a CSV file. And if I open that up, we will see that file, again, just waiting for Excel to open that up, that has the structure of the Dublin Core metadata template. Okay, so we don't change anything about this. We don't change the header, we don't change the wording across any of that. Otherwise, the upload of this metadata file will not work. Okay, now the only additional field that we have is the file name. So that's added on to the standard Dublin Core template so that we can identify the file that we are associating the metadata with. So the file name has to match the exact name of the file we're uploading. So what I'm doing is I'm going to copy from my prepared metadata file into this template. Okay, so I'm just going to bring that across as well and attempt to copy all of that from here. So just going to select all of that. So mine's been prepared in a format that's pretty simple in terms of I've just got to copy this and paste it into here. Okay, because everything's already aligned. It may not be as simple in terms of if you've got it in a text format or an XML format, you may need to sort of do a bit of preparation outside of that. Okay, so I've got my file name, which corresponds to those three assets, those three files, and then the metadata for that, and I'm going to save it. Okay, so I've now got in my prepared folder my three assets, my CSV file, and my prepared Dublin Core metadata file. Okay, and I'm actually going to move this file out, so I don't want to ingest my prepared file, I only want to ingest the CSV file. So I'm just going to take that out and put that into here. Okay, because otherwise it will preserve that XLS file, which I don't need. And obviously Excel requires me to be out of that before I can do that. So quick recap, I now have my three files and my prepared metadata file in CSV format. So I should be good to go. So let's just move that out of the way again. And over here, I can now click on upload a folder with metadata using one of the templates. So when I click on that, it's now asking me to go to that location where all of that content is, which is this folder here. Click on upload, It's then asking me to confirm that I want to do that, and I click on upload. Okay, so upload in progress. It's now uploading that folder with the three assets and the metadata file in it. Okay, so we just wait for that to complete. That's completed, but I now need to complete some actions over here. Okay, so the first action I need to do is to select the metadata file. So it's now asking me out of the content in that folder, what file is the metadata file? Now it'll only select or make available anything that's a CSV file. Okay, so there is only one option. I also renamed it just to make sure it's really obvious what the metadata file is. So I've selected that. I then need to choose the appropriate metadata schema, which is Dublin Core, and the appropriate delimiter. In this case, it was a comma delimiter. You could have tab as well if you wanted. Okay, once that's selected, the complete ingest button will become active, and I can click on that, and that will now go ahead and hopefully upload that metadata with that content. However, it's returned some, it says errors, but actually they're warnings, because potentially I could just carry on here, okay, and complete the upload. But let's examine what this is telling us. So it's telling us that there are files without associated file names, and that some rows include file names that don't have an associated file. Okay, so first of all, what it's doing here is it's telling me that it can't find any metadata for the actual folder that it's bringing in, okay? Which is, yep, fine. I'm not bringing in metadata for the folder. I'm only bringing in metadata for the files. So I can ignore that message, or to get around it, I could put this folder name as a file, as a fourth line in my CSV file. So I'm happy to ignore that one. What's more concerning is the fact that I've got this and this. So what this is telling me is that I've made a mistake in my preparation by not mapping the file name correctly to the file name itself. Okay, so I'm going to cancel the ingest and go back into my preparation folder. And the problem was this one here. So I've got this JPEG 2000 file here. And if I go into my prepared CSV file and open up file name, yep, okay, I called it a JPEG, not a JPEG 2000. So the validation is correct, and the human error is to blame there. So I'm going to rename that to JPEG 2000, save that, and then obviously exit from the spreadsheet. So let's try again. So back to add, back to upload. Select the folder and click on upload. Okay, so this time again, it's going to upload that content and then move on to the action required step. So once again, I need to confirm that this is the metadata file. It's in Dublin Core, comma, delimited format, and complete the ingest. Okay, so I've still got the warning about the folder not having any metadata associated with it. I'm fine with that. But it's now removed that problem I had with the file name mismatch, because I fixed the extension to JPEG from JPEG 2000. So yep, I understand, continue. So that's now gonna continue the ingest, and what we'll see is the preserving workflow complete again. We can close that one and go through those steps. So it's now up again, uploading those three assets in that folder along with the metadata associated with it. So again, that will take a few seconds to complete. Okay, so confirmation that that's completed. I can hide the notifications for that. There's my folder. So again, in the background, thumbnails, migrations completing, but I can go straight into my assets. And if I click on an asset, I can see immediately the metadata is still there. Okay, so all the metadata associated with each of those assets now displays in there. Okay, so I've very quickly uploaded and added that metadata alongside my content. The work is really in the preparation in terms of making sure that you have your metadata organized. You then downloaded that template, put in the correct file name, which I didn't do, and then upload and ingest that. So what you can also do in bulk is bulk metadata editing. So this is a feature within Starter Plus. So it allows you to bulk add metadata templates and then bulk update, replace, or clear metadata within the assets itself. So this is done at folder level. So if I go back to my folder, first folder that I ingested. Okay, so within there, my three assets, yes, I've got some metadata for my 1847, but I haven't got any metadata associated with these other two. So what I can do is I can right click on this folder and we see the function down here, bulk edit metadata. Okay, so the first step is to add the template itself. I can't add metadata if the template doesn't exist. So I need to click on that and it says, yes, you need to do this step before you can do anything else. It may take a bit of time to complete with this amount of content, not very long at all. So obviously if you're applying it to hundreds or thousands of assets, it will take a bit longer. So the first thing I need to do is select the template. Again, I'll stick with Dublin Core. And I'm going to add metadata template. Again, little warning about potentially taking some time. Yes, I'm fine with that. And again, another notification about that. Okay. So if I now drill down back into that folder and select one of these assets that didn't have that Dublin Core, we now see that that template is added. Okay, so it didn't take very long at all, a few seconds for that to be added. So now the template's been added. What I can do is go back up to the folder, right click on the folder and go to step two, which is the bulk edit metadata. So now I've added the template. I can say, yes, I've done that. And in fact, I don't want to see that again. Yes, I have added it. So I've now got the three options of updating, replacing, or clearing. Okay, well, I can't replace or clear because I don't have any metadata yet. So yes, I want to update my Dublin Core. And let's put in, say, the date with today's date. So we'll put in today's date. Okay. And then I'm going to do update all. So again, it's warning me that it may overwrite anything that's already there. Yep, thanks for warning me about that. I'm going to proceed anyway. So again, that's going to run in the background, won't take particularly long for that to complete. And again, I can drill down into my folder. And if I select that same asset as before, I can now see that date is populated. Great. Okay. Actually, I put the wrong date in. So it should have been yesterday's date. Let's go back, right click on the folder, bulk edit metadata, and choose replace. So I want to replace my Dublin Core date of 14th July 2022 with yesterday's date. Okay, so we'll make that the 13th. Let's replace all. Yes, again, let's overwrite that. So again, that'll complete quickly. Back into our asset. And there we go. Again, updated quickly. If I want to remove any metadata that exists, that's our third option. So again, under bulk edit metadata, I have that clear option. Okay, so if I want to remove metadata that exists in a field within a template, I can say, yep, actually, let's remove the date completely. So I'll choose the date field, clear all, again, yes, overwriting that. That will complete. Back into here. And again, we can drill down into our asset. And now we're back to no metadata at all. So the metadata template will remain. So I don't have to add that again, but in terms of any metadata in there, that has now been removed from that particular field. Okay, so that covers operating at scale and concludes the training session. So just a reminder to have a go yourself using your own content or an example worksheet that will be made available. So I'll hand back again to Laurie.
Thanks, Paul. I know that when Starter was first launched, the bulk metadata editing and upload option wasn't available. So Aubrey, I was wondering if you could just let people know how input and requests from Starter users is handled. And I know that's part of your job, but how does it make its way into the product roadmap?
Absolutely. Well, you can think of me, your onboarding specialist, as kind of a direct line to Preservica. So I have weekly meetings with our team where we're discussing just this, adding value to the product. And so features like the bulk metadata add and edit comes from user feedback, and it comes from, you know, the conversations that we're having with all of you. So if there are features that you see in this product that you're like, why doesn't this have this feature? I am more than happy to have that conversation with you, and I can bring it directly to the team. So everybody is here to listen to your feedback. They're excited to hear your feedback. We want to make this product what you need in your archive. So it's really a fantastic listening group of people at Preservica. They're here to actually understand your feedback, take that feedback, and then make it real, bring it into the product. So you do have that direct line through me, and any kind of conversations you have and any suggestions you want to make here in the comments or on the community hub or directly to me via email or over Teams call, I'm more than happy to do that. But we want to make this product for you, for archivists. So I am always here to listen and take that feedback and hopefully make it into a product that suits all of your needs.
Thanks, Aubrey. Aubrey's your listening post. So we want to encourage you to try Starter. I think Paul's done a great job of showing you how powerful and yet flexible it is and friendly. So we encourage you to try this exercise. It's available on the Canadian Starter Group on the Community Hub. But as Paul said, you know, feel free to use your own content as well. But get out there and give it a try. And if there's something you want to say, then reach out to Aubrey. So just a reminder, this is, you know, what we're trying to do. We're trying to create a trusted digital repository that has that great, safe, and intelligent storage in the cloud. It's got this automated transformation that you've now seen a couple of times, the file format recycling. Paul's shown you that it can take in lots of different files. And then, of course, the public portal allows people to actually get to your content, to search for it, to understand its characteristics and its important features through the metadata. So we really hope that you'll be trying Starter between now and the next time that we get together. But now I am so pleased to introduce Jillian Stanek, who is Archives Coordinator for the City of Red Deer. And she's got some great tips to tell you about what they do at the City of Red Deer Archives and her adventure in archiving. And I will tell you, in our conversation yesterday, Jillian said part of what she wants to do is, you know, take back the word archive from IT. And I think it's just what she's doing is very, very powerful. And I think that you'll be really interested in what she has to say. So, Jillian, thank you so much for joining us. And please share your story.
Excellent. Thank you so much. That was a nice introduction. And thanks for having me. I'm hoping that this will be of interest to people, even though we don't use Preservica Starter, we use Cloud Edition. So some of this is honestly not quite as pretty as Starter. It's a really nice interface. I played with it as well. And it's such an exciting product. But yeah, what my presentation is going to focus on today is how we're getting our Preservica and our internal databases to work together, not directly, but the systems and processes that we're using to make that possible. Oh, I forgot to click on that button. There we go. So quick presentation should be a little bit about information about us, the City of Red Deer Archives, a little bit about how we get our records into Preservica, which is a bit different than what you do in Starter, and then where we're going next. Can I close that? Maybe just that angle there. That's how. First up, of course, for myself, I'm currently physically located on Treaty 6 and 7 territory. Obviously, you might be in other places. These are the traditional meeting grounds and gathering place and traveling route for the Cree, Soto, Blackfoot, Métis, Dene, Nakota Sioux, Siksika, Pekani, Kainani, no, I never say that one right, but Sutina and Stony Nakota Nations. It's a big site that many nations have moved through and used for generations. At the City Archives, we're working right now to incorporate the needs of these nations into our activities, including our digital preservation and digitization projects. So I encourage you to find out or know whose land you're on today and consider how that could inform your activities as well. Aside from where we are, a little bit more information about who we are as well. So Red Deer is a mid-sized city in Alberta. Our archival collection is a total archives. So we do community collections through donation, and we also acquire and preserve and make accessible the city records, which come through our records schedule process. The archives itself is part of the information management services section in the IMTS department. So we're combined with RIM, well, not combined, but we work closely with records management and the print and mail room as part of the IMS. And then the information and technology services department serves the city needs as a corporation, as well as a lot of community connections as well. Directly. We have a fair amount of physical collections, about 2 kilometers of textual records, about 20,000 maps and plans, might be more, 5,000-ish videos and films, about 200,000 photos and negatives. And then for our digital collections, we have about 100 terabytes of digital and digitized records. We're digitizing more records all the time. We've got our own in-house video digitization, and of course we're scanning photos, or VHS digitization specifically, and we've also done a lot of video digitization projects, and that's really informed a lot of what we're doing with Preservica. For Preservica, it came about because while we have our internal systems, which is in Magic DB Textworks for archival databases, OpenText eDocs, and now M365 for our internal records management and records creation, we really needed to provide public access. We know that there are opportunities and ways to do that within Magic, but we wanted to also do the preservation side at the same time. We need a place to dispo the open text records too. We've never done a digital disposition out of that system. And we also would like to collect some born digital records like website and social media preservation. In the future, we needed to work with M365, which is new for us in the last year or so. and down the road, we expect it. We might also need it to support our public donations process. So around 2018-2019, we signed on with Preservica CE, so Cloud Edition. Through that, we're able to do some of those digital, born digital records, like the WARCs, the web archiving. We can now do Twitter, we're part of that group, which is fantastic. So Preservica, we set the rules that Preservica does the crawls, pulls the tweets, all of that. And then our other big step right from the start was importing our records from InMagic into Preservica. which we started and will continue to do. We still continue to do that. We're literally doing it today. So we launched our public site in 2020, January 2020, which is really good timing, and we'll learn a little bit more about that. But first, we had to get our systems connected in order to get those records and the metadata into Preservica and make it available. We've ended up using a combination of manual and automated solutions. We've developed some in-house programs to work with it. And all of this was done with a ton of support from Preservica. They are not paying me to say this. In fact, they were like, you don't need to talk about us, which is very kind of them. But the support that we've received, I think, is something that I really want to emphasize, because we've had transform information, like how to transform our metadata, import challenges, public access challenges, and they've really helped us along with every single piece of that as we're going. And so I wanted to give a quick moment for that. I'm going to go through a bunch of screenshots of what we're doing to export, modify, and import, what our flow is. If you want to see a live version of it because you're using any of these systems, let me know and I can do a one-on-one with you with a live version. I just know that anytime you do a presentation, it's never going to quite work out the way you expect it to. And again, we're using Preservica and CE and other programs that you might not use. So I'm just going to quickly go through what we're doing versus like hiding too much in the details and the weeds, especially because, again, the systems are a little bit different and some of these things you won't need to do them in Starter, which is exciting for you. So again, our export, modify, and import flow always starts with creating. We create our metadata in InMagic databases. We have video ones, photo ones, map databases, all separate pieces. We like InMagic because it's a really simple database program. It's old-fashioned, it's kind of clunky, or at least our version of it is. I'm sure there's nicer, newer versions out there, but it is extremely reliable. It's all hosted in-house. It takes basically no maintenance, which is really nice, and it's very easily modifiable. So that's why we started putting our metadata in there for every digitized item and our accessions and our reference database, and why we continue to do so even though we are using Preservica for the preservation of these records and for public access. It's just nice to know that this is always there. It's so consistent. And because we got them working together, it's not that challenging to get the metadata out of this and get our records up into Preservica. So essentially it's our spreadsheet that you were using before. We just use a database for it. Our next step after we create that is to export it. We only export selected fields, and we choose to export it in XML, in part because the CSV versions of these exports out of InMagic don't work well, and in part because of some of the challenges we had with CSV files early on when we were using Preservica. So again, part of that is because the field titles that we use in our database are not Dublin Core compliant, and that's going to come up. Plus, InMagic adds a bunch of extra stuff on top of that as well. So yeah, so we select our fields and then export our subsection of our fields. We don't import some of our more sensitive information, just lives in our internal databases, just for privacy concerns and reassuring our FOIP officer. We then modify our information, which involves a couple of different steps. So first we have to transform the information on the left-hand side. You'll see the what comes out, which is INNM, colon, with a capital R, results, all those kinds of things. Our video database is much closer to Dublin Core compliant, which is helpful. Our photo database is completely the wrong names. So we need to transform those from non-compliant to compliant Dublin Core information. And you can see a compliant description or Dublin Core on the right-hand side. So this, we ended up doing a little bit of programming stuff. We got, again, a ton of help from Preservica to get what that needed to look like and what the formatting needs to be with that OAIC and or OAI underscore DC, all of that piece. And then we made macros. So we saved the transform, and you click on the video one and it'll transform video records. If you click on the photo macro, it'll transform our photo macro. We then have to split these. So because we had challenges with doing multiple metadata and multiple items, we split it so that each metadata goes up with each of its individual items. It's worked very consistently for us. Again, I think in Starter, you might not need to do that, but for our needs, it's really helped us out. It's also helped us find issues. So we built this file splitter, and we can do TIFF, MP4, MOV, whatever we want to split, any file extension we want. And it will automatically put our unique identifiers, which is that P number you see there, pull it out of the file and put that as the title, and then .tiff or .whatever, .metadata. We then modify these titles so that we add read your archives underscore in front of this. We do that for all of our images, or all of our uploads, and all of our metadata. They must match, the names must match, if you do it this way with splits. And we do that because, or as you notice with the JPEG 2000 versus JPEG, right? Everything has to match, or else it can't, Preservica can't put together the metadata and the items. And we do the Red Deer Archives underscore our unique identifier because we provide access to these as downloads, and we want them to download with that, with our name in it and with the unique identifier. So we use Adobe Bridge to do that. We have Photoshop, and therefore we have Adobe Bridge. So it was an easy choice for us to make. We then import them. Generally speaking, we're using the put system, for which is very similar to your input options, but for the very large video files, which can be quite large, we've had to put those directly into cloud or into AWS, and we use Cloudberry systems for that. So importing through Cloudberry, if you haven't done that before, again, Preservica helped us with the setup, so that we can get things directly from our systems, which is my computer, straight into Preservica's holdings in the AWS server. You basically just move it over, copy it over, actually, yes. But yeah, it's worked fairly consistently. And then from inside the system, again, we're using the Preservica upload tool put. We can just drag and drop smaller items right into here, or we use the access holding area, select the set of things we wanted. I just did this with a sample photo set, just so you can see what that looks like. Move it into it, takes a while to load, and then it loads. These are similar questions to what you're seeing in Starter of the, you can choose metadata files. If you have a CSV in your folder, you can select that into here. But generally speaking, we just play with the fixity, we choose which folder we want it to move into, set a name so that we can find this in our storage afterward, and then save and upload it. From there, we then verify everything. And I love some of the demonstration today showed a lot of this verification as well. The first verification, of course, is always, did it upload? And so you want it to say done, it's good. We then verify in, again, CE, the interface isn't quite as nice as Starter, but it has a bit more technical information that's easy to find if you need to find it. So ingest, you can watch ingest. It also does the validations to make sure that it's the only copy of it. Did you mean to add two copies of it? That kind of thing. We also then validate what goes into our systems. So here I on purpose uploaded something that isn't actually a TIFF. It was the metadata that didn't tie to an item. So you can see it's not looking like an item. Why doesn't it look like an item? And then collect that information by clicking on the item and getting into it and figuring out why didn't this upload. Our system doesn't spit out as many errors as as Starter. Starter gives you those warnings saying, hey, you don't have metadata. Hey, you don't have an item. Here, they just assume that we know what we're doing. We're not going to make those mistakes. So we have to figure them out ourselves. Another advantage of Starter there. We also verify in the details that our Dublin Core went in properly. We've had some problems where we didn't actually format it correctly, so we make sure that works. We also ensure that we have our preservation and our access copy, which they were demonstrating with Starter. Same thing, just make sure that it exists. Once we know it does, we modify the permissions. Right-click, I think, is very similar to what you were doing there with our terminology is open or public. I think yours is private or public. Either way, you get to decide either on the item level or on a folder level or on a top level folder level, which things you want to make available. We then create links. So we'll do links into collection folders. If it's all these images are from the same font, we'll put it as a collection folder. We link it to a photograph, so it's publicly available through a link at our top level. And we also move them into our photograph storage. Public access was a huge focus for us and a huge need. Again, we happened to launch in January 2020, and of course, everything shut down in March 2020, so it was great to have universal access and have our site up. We put everything that's available for public is stuff that we either own the copyright on or it's public domain. So everything that we have on our site, redeer.access.preservica.com, is available for download. Again, that's why we use our naming scheme that we do with each of the items, our videos and photos, is so that people can download it, use it as they want, and hopefully tie it back to us if they need another copy of it or they want a higher quality version or anything like that. Where we're going next, of course, is always a little bit interesting. So big stuff for us is going to be those open text dispositions of e-records, and then M365 and Preserve 365. We're not part of the beta group for Preserve 365. I think we're early adopters. This is exciting for us because we don't actually have real records in M365, theoretically, yet. So this is a way to build that in right from the start as we're launching M365 and building our records management into it. Another thing that we're working on is our social media preservation. As I said, we've got it set up for Twitter right now, but we don't really have the policy around it that we need. We have been continuing to use InMagic for our metadata creation, and I think we probably will because it is very inexpensive and very easy to maintain. And again, because it is working quite well with Preservica, but we'll see. And then we're also exploring the potential of the community donations update that is coming out for at least Preservica CE relatively soon, and see if we can use that as a system option instead of the systems that we have been using. So if you have any follow-up questions after today, you can contact me at the phone number or email below. I know I'm on the community hub, so I think you can message me there as well. But I don't really know how that works, for sure. So I don't want to overpromise and underdeliver there. But yeah, I think we've now got an open question period for everybody. So hand it back to the Preservica folks.
Thanks, Jillian. That's great stuff. You really, really worked hard, and appreciate you taking the time to share what's going on at the City of Red Deer Archives. There is a question for you, so I'm going to ask that one first so we don't run out of time. And that is, does Preservica allow for playback of your works, your web archival collections, in a way that looks slash behaves like the live website?
Yes, at least internally. We haven't made any of our works available to the public, so I'd have to double check that the public can view them as websites. We also set how low into the site it will go. So depending on that, it could look less like a website or function less like a website, right? If you don't go 10 levels deep and the website goes 10 levels deep, it won't necessarily function the same, right? But you are able to view it yourself within Preservica. You can also download it and open it up in a viewer, which we've done a couple of times just to ensure that we can verify what's happening with those works. But yeah, I'm not sure if the public would be able to browse them the same way just because we haven't tested that. But now I want
to. So maybe Emily can check back with you in a little bit of time and get an answer on that. There was a question from Christine Ardern, which I answered, which was about are all of those transformations being saved and does that obviously impact storage? The answer is yes, it does. So I think maybe in the next session, Paul, when you could show the dashboard too and help people see where storage is tracked. But absolutely, every one of those, the original and all the transformations are being stored and stored in multiple instances on the cloud, right? Because that's part of what the repository does. So Paul can show you the dashboard next time and you can watch how the storage is and also what file formats have been ingested. There's a question for Paul. When Paul uploaded the first folder, I noticed the file format it was being uploaded was zip. Does this happen automatically for folder or bulk uploads?
Yep, so the content is packaged into a zip file for upload and then unpackaged as part of the ingest itself.
Okay, another question, is there any way to search for personally identifiable information or personal identifying information amongst your assets before you make them public?
Yep, so if that content exists in a metadata field, then when you run a search, there's a search bar at the top of Starter, that will search that index metadata and return the results. Depends slightly on what you mean by personally identifiable, but basically anything that would exist in the title, description, or any metadata field will be returned in a search result.
And then there's a question, can metadata values be automatically populated? I noticed in the Dublin Core metadata fields, there was a file format option. Can this be automatically captured and populated? And I answered part of this question, which was on the ingest, the technical metadata, the file format, the size, mm-hmm. The hash digest, all of that's captured and you can see that over in the advanced information. But Paul or Aubrey, if you wanted to add to that.
I think you've answered it there, Laurie. I think, yeah, technical information, yeah, is captured automatically. Descriptive metadata, as you've seen, can be uploaded automatically through the bulk upload function. But otherwise, yeah, you'd be adding that content manually.
So I think part of the answer to all the questions is try it in Starter and see for yourself what happens, what metadata is captured, what's going on with the storage, what's the dashboard telling you about the file formats and the transformation and the activity. So I think all of us want to really encourage you between now and the next time to put some of your own assets in. Don't be afraid. You can, as Paul showed, you can always recycle them and restore them. And so we want you to be brave and go ahead and try Starter for yourself, because if you're looking at assets that are meaningful to you, that's really the best way to learn what Starter is doing and for you to see that. So let's see. I think we're almost out of time. So let's just move on for a brief recap on just start that. The next session, which is going to be on August 4th, so you get a little bit of time off to practice with Starter. And we're going to turn our attention to building the business case. So I think Jillian did a great job of saying we had a need, we had people we needed to convince, we had decisions to make about solutions. We've had lots of decisions since then about our workflow, how we're going to proceed, who's going to do what, how we're going to do it, which systems we're going to connect to, and what we're going to encounter. So we want to spend some time with you, giving you some of the advice and sharing some other insights on how do you build the business case for the digital repository that we know you all need. And then on August 18th, we'll finish by looking to the future and bring some of our experts back to share their insights with you. So next steps for you, we hope, are to visit the Community Hub, which Aubrey and David showed you how to get there. Try the worksheet or go ahead and just try with your own assets some of the things in Starter. Look for future communications. We'll keep you posted on what's happening. And then please join us again so that you can get your certificate at the end for attending the four courses. So with that, I want to thank you so much for your time and attention. We are delighted to have you with us and delighted to hear from you. So please speak to us after the session And we will answer all the questions again, as Aubrey said, before next time, and hopefully we'll see you in August. So thank you and take care.